BBC Audio presents Unearthing Britannia's Tribes, an epic collection of radio programmes that explores the tribes, rulers and civilizations of Britain's Iron Age. Part 1. Context. Opening this British collection is the In Our Time episode The Iron Age, in which presenter Melvyn Bragg discusses the dawning of the European Iron Age, as well as the transition from bronze to iron with his guests. Featuring Barry Cunliffe, Sue Hamilton, and Timothy Champion, this programme was produced by Thomas Morris. It was first broadcast on BBC Radio 4 on the 24th of March, 2011.
Hello. In 1907, during the construction of the Brooklands motor racing track in Surrey, workmen uncovered the remains of a prehistoric village. The objects they found included a bronze bucket and a hoard of Roman coins. But perhaps the most interesting discovery of all was the remains of a furnace, dating from 5th century BC and used for smelting iron. The Brooklands furnace was the earliest evidence of iron production yet discovered in Britain. Until the beginning of the first millennium BC, tools had been mainly made from bronze. The introduction of ironworking to Europe in the following centuries was one of the great technological breakthroughs of history, and the beginning of the Iron Age was accompanied by significant changes in societies, lifestyles and cultures across the continent. With me to discuss the dawn of the European Iron Age are Timothy Champion, Professor of Archaeology at the University of Southampton, Sue Hamilton, Professor of Prehistory at the Institute of Archaeology, University College London, and Barry Cunliffe, Emeritus Professor of European Archaeology at the Institute of Archaeology at the University of Oxford. Tim Champion, prehistory is commonly divided into three eras, the Stone Age, the Bronze Age, the Iron Age. What exactly do those terms mean, and how did that classification originate?
Well, the classification started in Denmark in the early 19th century as a means of trying to find order in the rapidly accumulating evidence of prehistory. It was building up in what was then called the Museum of Northern Antiquities, which is now the National Museum of Denmark in Copenhagen. And it was the work of the curator called Christian Thompson, who noticed that among this mass of material, there were sort of three groups, and with very little other lines of evidence about how to order them, he suggested that what we had was three successive phases where different materials were used as the prime material for making everyday tools and weapons. So a Stone Age, a Bronze Age, and an Iron Age, as represented in the finds they had in the museum. And that was how he displayed them in the museum.
And that caught on very quickly, didn't it?
With some opposition at first. Other people had other ideas derived from the classical or biblical chronologies, but...
And what would those be?
Well, in Britain, for instance, in England, we had a history of Roman conquest with the conquest in 43 AD, and everything before that was lumped together as ancient British. And there was a very short chronology. People didn't realise how long prehistory was. So the idea that you needed separate ages in a short prehistory, even that seemed strange to some people. But yes, it did eventually catch on, and by about the 1860s, it was accepted by most people, and people were beginning to put absolute dates on it.
We're interested this morning in the transition from the Bronze Age to the Iron Age. Can you give us some approximation of when that occurred? I realise these dates are not only long ago, but very approximate. But
very approximate.
Given that, yeah.
Well, I think the first thing is it happened at slightly different times in different parts of Europe, but probably the earliest transition would be in Southeast Europe and Greece from about 1050 BC, and in Western Europe, including Britain, from about 750 BC.
So, Hamilton, the Bronze Age began in Europe around 3,300 BC. Let's consider, is that right? Let's consider the metal, well, around there, you correct me, please do. Let's consider the metal first of all. Tell us about bronze and how it's made and what significance it has.
Well, I think the key thing about bronze is that it isn't iron, and I think it's very easy to lump metals together as if they all function in the same way, and conceptually they may have been considered to be quite different things by prehistoric societies. So bronze is synthetic. It's a combination of copper as its main ingredient, and added to that is tin, maybe up to 8 or 9% of the mixture. And that takes us through to the later Bronze Age, till about maybe 1300 BC, when something else is added, which is lead, and it's added up to about 3%. So it's a synthetic material. It's made of several materials brought together. And the key to adding them is that it changes the quality of the copper. The copper is soft and malleable, and with some contamination, it becomes harder. So tin is added to make it harder, but too much tin will make it brittle. So there's a mixture that has to be achieved. When you add lead in addition, it makes it less viscous, much more fluid, much more easy to cast, and you can therefore do more. Once it's lead bronze, you can cast it. All bronze is cast, but by the time you get to lead, you can make more complicated shapes. And something else which is very important is that you can beat it. You can beat it into sheets of metal. You can rivet it together. So you can make many different types of objects by the time we have lead bronze.
Broadly, what was the significance of bronze over the, as it were, 2,000 years from about 3,300 BC to about 1,200 BC?
In a broad sense, you have to also see that it starts off as copper. So in some places, you have copper first before you have it contaminated with the mixture. And of course, copper is very soft, so the significance of it is potentially social as much as a tool. It's made into ornaments and smaller objects, which may be symbolic. By the time you've got tin added, you have potential to make more elaborate tools, daggers, for instance, if you want to call that a tool, or a weapon or a symbol, and jewellery. We have ornament horizons in the Middle Bronze Age, so people have ways of adorning and distinguishing themselves. But it really takes until the Late Bronze Age, when you have lead, to get a full repertoire of tools. So by that stage, metal is a facilitator in a very broad way in terms of warfare, armoury and daily tools for craftspeople.
A lot of the bronze findings are very splendid, and I read of a society of warrior aristocratic elites either in fortresses or in settlements, and this was part of not only their ornamentation but their show of wealth and their show of power. Can you develop that?
Well, by the early Bronze Age, we have metal, which...
Early Bronze Age, we're talking about...
It would vary, but by 2000 BC, you've got established communities. By 1800 BC, in Britain, for instance, you would call that early Bronze Age.
Right.
So during that period, we have a small-scale use of metal, but it is found in some extremely rich burials with what I'd call exotica. So you would have beaten golden objects, bronze daggers, but you'd also have amber beads, shale beads, faience, which is a technology using contaminated glass to make blue glass. And these are objects which are symbolic of the power of individual people who are buried under tumuli in the early Bronze Age. So there is an emphasis on identifying people in death with bronze as an elite material. As we go into the Middle Bronze Age, it's quite patchy. Different parts of Europe have different evidence of social stratigraphy, but by the time we get to the Late Bronze Age, quite clearly again, metalwork is being used to distinguish warrior burials in particular. But by the Late Bronze Age, there's a new ideology in terms of most of the burials are cremated burials, and there's a lot of aligned changes alongside the use of bronze to identify warriors and also craftspeople by ranges of tools.
Barry Cunliffe, first of all, just to develop this idea of the societies, I sort of skipped through with a couple of sentences. Can you develop that? What were these societies over those 2,000 years? Can you give us more detail about that?
Well, I think everywhere where you've got people living together, they develop ways of articulating with each other, ways of articulating with their neighbours. So you get a palimpsest of different groups relating to each other, and it's a very, very complex picture across Europe. So
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.